mechanism for managing the South China Sea tensions. And we have distinguished panelists. And before I will leave the introduction to the chair, I would like to introduce Professor Robert Beckman, Head of Ocean Law and Policy Program Center for International Law, the National University of Singapore, who chairs the session. Professor Beckman, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you all to session 7. We're starting a little bit late, but we hope to finish a little bit early and to give you a coffee break by 3, so hopefully our speakers can keep to their time and we'll still have time for questions. To lead off, we have an old friend of mine from Austria who is a former judge of the International Tribunal for Law of the Sea, currently ambassador and chairman of the Review Committee of the International Seabed Authority. He'll be speaking to us on global institutions and their roles, ITLOS, the ISA, and the CLCS. So, Mr. Kirk.
Thank you very much. Well, first of all, I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to the Diplomatic Academy of Vietnam, the Foundation for East Sea Studies, and the Vietnam Lawyers Association for having invited me to this highly important international conference on cooperation for regional security and development. I've attended quite a number of similar conferences, but I would say this one trumps, if one may use this word, all the previous ones. Well, this afternoon, I will give you a short overview about the global institutions created by the Law of the Sea Convention. My presentation will be one of a general nature. The specifics will be dealt with by the following speakers. But I thought this general presentation would be a useful roundup for the entire set of topics discussed at this conference. So as you are aware, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea established 3 institutions: the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, the International Seabed Authority, and the Commission on the Limits of the Continental Shelf. Although the structure, composition, and area of competence of these institutions are quite different, they are nevertheless to be considered complementary, as their task is to serve the states parties to the convention in ensuring its coherent and efficient implementation, at the same time securing the peaceful uses of the seas and the undisputed exploitation of maritime resources as a matter of common interest. To this institutional framework created by the convention, I should also like to mention the meeting of states parties, which is convened annually by the United Nations Secretary General and has certain administrative tasks like electing the members of the tribunal and the Commission on the Limits of the Continental Shelf to approve the budget of the tribunal and to convene the sessions of the commission. It is controversial whether the meeting of states parties might also play a wider role in overseeing the further development of the law of the sea. In any case, it is the United Nations General Assembly that has been accepted by the international community as being best placed for that task. Now, the tribunal became operational on 1st October 1996 and recently celebrated its 20th anniversary. It is the specialized international judicial body for the settlement of disputes and for the rendering of advisory opinion, consisting of 21 judges with recognized competence in the field of the law of the sea, representing the principal legal systems in various geographical regions. The tribunal is open to states parties to the convention, other states, as well as other entities such as international organizations and natural or legal persons, in any case expressly provided for in Part 11 of the convention, which relates to the exploration and exploitation of the international seabed area. So you may consider access to be the major difference between the International Court of Justice and the Law of the Sea Tribunal. However, the tribunal is only one of the 4 means for the settlement of disputes entailing binding decisions. The other means are International Court of Justice an arbiter tribunal constituted in accordance with Annex 7 and a special arbiter tribunal under Annex 8 for certain categories of disputes. This flexibility for the choice of fora was indispensable in order to achieve consensus on compulsory dispute settlement at the Third United Nations Conference on the Law of the Sea. The principal provision regarding the settlement of disputes dealt with in Part 15 of the Convention is Article 287, which provides that a state party is free to choose one or more of these four means of submission of a written declaration to the UN Secretary General. So far, 52 states have made such a declaration, 39 of which have chosen the Law of the Sea Tribunal as the preferred procedure or as one possibility. In the absence of such a declaration, or if the parties have not accepted the same procedure under Article 287, they are deemed to have accepted arbitration under Annex 7, which is thus the default procedure. The jurisdiction of the tribunal, in principle, includes any dispute relating to the Law of the Sea. It is, however, subject to certain limitations and optional exceptions, such as those relating to sea boundary delimitations. I will not go into detail in this respect for lack of time, but what is also interesting to note that there is the possibility for advisory opinions to be rendered by the Seabed Disputes Chamber, which deals with disputes relating to the international seabed area, and also by the full tribunal. In its 20 years of existence, the tribunal has established a reputation for an expeditious and efficient management of cases. Altogether, 25 cases have been submitted, and including two advisory opinions, which have provided a good opportunity for making a number of important pronouncements, such as regarding freedom of navigation, nationality of ships, use of force on the seas, protection of the marine environment, delimitation of the continental shelf beyond 200 nautical miles, obligation of states sponsoring activities in the international seabed area, and obligations of flag states and international organizations regarding IUU fishing. I will not mention any specific case, once again, for lack of time. Just let me say that the tribunal also makes every effort to keep abreast of developments in other international judicial fora, in particular the International Court of Justice, in order to avoid fragmentation of international law, because there is certainly such a danger if you have several possibilities for dispute resolution. It is to be regretted that the Convention does not grant the tribunal the privilege of being the default procedure instead of arbitration, because it should be borne in mind, decision-making by an ad hoc arbiter tribunal with a limited membership, 3 or 5 arbitrators, may lead to a less weighted opinion than a judgment by the members of a larger court or tribunal composed of judges from all geographical regions and representing the principal legal systems. And a judgment by a permanent institution may also carry more authority and at the same time also more political weight. Although the tribunal is still underutilized as a relatively new permanent institution, it can rightly be regarded as being at the center of the dispute resolution system of the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. Now, International Seabed Authority, which became operational in 1996, administering the international seabed area as a trustee of mankind. We don't know where exactly the international seabed area ends and where the continental shelves begin, because this requires a delineation of the outer edge of the continental margin by the coastal states, and so far not many states have effected such a delineation. Let me also add that all states parties to the convention are ipso facto members of the authority at present, 168 including the European Union. When the Seabed Authority came into existence, it was not a universal acclaim. Many states, particularly those less satisfied with the provisions relating to the international seabed area, had no great desire to see it succeed as an international organization. In the meantime, the authority has adopted a set of regulations on prospecting and exploration for polymetallic nodules, polymetallic sulfides, and cobalt-rich ferromanganese crusts. It has so far approved 28 contracts for exploration covering areas of the seabed of more than 1.2 million square kilometers. And now the next phase will be the exploitation phase, and a first draft of regulations on exploitation for mineral resources in the international seabed area has been released this year. So there are certain prospects of slowly moving from the exploration phase to the exploitation phase, and these prospects seem much brighter than only a few years ago. Now finally, Commission of the Limits of the Continental Shelf. Why was such a commission created? Its basic reason was that the convention substantially broadened the traditional concept of the continental shelf. There are many scientific questions to be resolved, so the commission is a 21-member body of experts in the field of geology, geophysics, or hydrography. But these members of the commission serve in a personal basis, while the tribunal and the seabed authority are autonomous international organizations. The commission is a treaty body. The commission has so far rendered 28 recommendations for coastal states to delineate the outer margin of the continental shelf, but altogether, to date, 77 submissions plus 4 revised submissions have been made. So it may take another 2 or more decades until the Commission will more or less have completed its work. It is also important to mention that there is a savings clause with regard to the role of the Commission, that it has no function in determining the continental shelf boundary between states with overlapping claims to entitlements beyond 200 nautical miles, nor is it to be involved in matters relating to the delimitation of the continental shelf between states. Thus, if there is a dispute in the region or the area, the Commission will defer consideration of the submission made by any coastal state. The workload of the Commission has been grossly underestimated at the conference on the law of the sea, because at that time it was considered that the number of coastal states with potential continental shelves extending beyond 200 nautical miles would be around 33. But now it turns out that this number may be between 80 and 100. And the total number of submissions to the CLCS will probably approach 120. So this was really an unforeseen development. So to sum up, Mr. Chairman, the three institutions created by the Law of the Sea Convention are working well. They are living up to the expectations of their founders. As regards the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, one would of course wish that states would make more use of the possibilities offered for the peaceful resolution of disputes, including the request for advisory opinions in order to clarify certain Law of the Sea issues. And this would not only benefit the parties concerned, but be also highly useful for the international community as a whole. I have 19 seconds left. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to make one comment relating what Judge Turk said to the South China Sea. Of course, the Malaysia and Vietnam made a joint submission to the Commission on Limits of the Continental Shelf in the South China Sea. Vietnam's made a separate submission, and Brunei and Philippines and China, I believe, have made preliminary information. So we're not sure at this point whether there will be any deep seabed in the South China Sea, but a very, very large portion of it is probably going to be the outer continental shelf of the coastal states, leaving only high seas fisheries to deal with the resources in the water column. Our next speaker is old friend again, Professor Lee Seok Woo of Inha University in Korea. He will be speaking to us on the South China Sea arbitration and beyond territorial maritime disputes. In glancing at its paper, we seem to have moved a little bit to East Asian Sea as well, and how it might relate to the South China Sea. So, Dr. Lee?
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I'd like to echo with the previous speakers to express my warm thanks to the organizer to invite me to part of this program. Today, I'm going to talk about the South China Sea arbitration, its implication of the East Asia, in particular from the view of the Korea. You know, the something happened in Korea domestically. We don't have any specific view on the South China Sea now. But we are very concerned of the arbitration, which means that almost every day we have a meeting in the ministry to deal with how we interpret of this outcome of this judgment. So what I'm going to today is give you the couple of the brief background issues, what happened in terms of the territorial maritime issues in East Asia, and what is the salient issues we have, and how we interpret those judgments, and then what we think about now. If you look at the map here, you see that Korea is surrounded by the major maritime powers of the world, China and Japan, and from the north is Russia. And with a very limited area, Korea do not have any fixed maritime boundary with the neighboring state. We don't have any maritime boundary to China, and we don't have any fixed maritime boundary with Japan. We do have the fisheries agreement that is a provisional the measures arrangement to govern the fisheries activities between the countries. We do have a sovereignty issue, and we do have a maritime delimitation issue, and we do have the illegal fishing activities issues and the law enforcement issues. And we also have some of the marine environment issues with neighboring state. And that is what I'm going to do today. The first, let me briefly talk about what we have with China. As you see that a couple of the slides here, this is a hypothetical easy line, and based on the fisheries arrangement, fisheries agreement to China and Korea. And the white dotting dot means that the Chinese fishing boats, which are largely inside of the Korean side of EEZ, and sometimes territorial sea, and sometimes internal sea of Korea. So it causes serious issues to Korea, so that sometimes Korea have to work with the United Nations command to operate to arrest the Chinese fishing vessels. And but the situation getting worse, and very recently, Korean Coast Guard employee to use the machine gun to arrest the Chinese fishing boats. There is no serious the casualties or the accidents reported yet, but the getting tense situation is one of the serious issues Korea has with China. The other issues is that if you look at this map here, there is a small the features you can find. That is actually underneath feature located within the hypothetical easy line of Korea. In the Chinese term is Suenchao, and Korea called that the Iodo, and the English name is Sokotra Rock. That is underneath feature. It's 4.6 meters below the water, and that the Korea government built this the Iodo Ocean Research Center over there. And luckily, both governments, China and Korea, they acknowledge that there is no territorial issues between two countries. Only issues they have is the maritime delimitation issues. And we know that that insulation do not have any impact for the in terms of the momentum delimitation. But that sometimes that causes a lot of tensions, in particular because some of the environmental the issues come up, and also the fishing activities issues come up. So that is a sort of the symbol of the tensions between two countries, China and Korea. And as you see that what happened in the South China Sea, some of the civic groups in Korea to say that we have to adopt the Chinese way to build the artificial the island around this underneath species. That is a current situation so far. Actually, the serious issues, in particular related with the judgment of arbitration, is about one of the small features between the Korea and Japan. We call the Dokdo, and the Japan is called the Takeshima. It's located just halfway of the Korea and the Japan. And that composed of the two islands, small island, is the size of island, 0.18 square kilometers. You know, the Itaba is almost the 0.5 square kilometers, three times bigger than the Dokdo. And the both country, I believe that they recognize this is island, but the Korean government do not declare the EEZ from this baseline. And the problem issues come up is that since we don't have any maritime delimitation yet, we are on the negotiation with the Japan side. But the problem is that from the 2009, the government tried to build quite similar with the Iodo, the ocean, the research observation center within the territorial sea of the Dokdo. That was opposed by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs Korea because Ministry of Foreign Affairs believed that they gave some issues to Japan to give some way to proceed the international litigation, including provincial measures to stop the building of that infrastructures over there. And after the arbitration was done, as you know that I think the yesterday one of the speakers talking about the how many countries go for to China and go against the judgment, Korea made a statement very next day of the arbitration awards landed. And then one of the two paragraphs, very simple one, and the first one is quite a neutral one, and the second one actually new one, the address by the ministry. This is very interesting. The Korea takes note of the arbitral award issued on July 12 and hope following the award that South China Sea disputes will be resolved through peaceful and creative diplomatic efforts. As you see that the Korea do not endorse any judgment, and maybe you indicate that this one is some of the idea that Korea have to go on the same line with the with this position. Because the reason for Korea have to go in the way is that we do have quite a similar declaration made in the 2006 when Korea was debated with Japan in terms of the Dokdo. In 2006, Japan tried to conduct a marine scientific research, and which by the Korean law have to get the prior permission from the Korean government. And the Japan is argued that this is a hydrographic survey, so don't need to get the prior permission from the Korea. So there is a huge debate, and it almost about to the physical conflict between two sides was luckily the solved by diplomatic way. But since we do have the quite a similar declaration, exactly the same one with China made, and we do have the territorial sovereignty issues and the maritime delimitation issues and other sailing issues, could have to be very low-key way to address this the arbitral award. And I think that yesterday when one of the sessions deal with the legal argument, they mentioned about a couple of the issues derived from the judgment, which I think the couple of things is very important for Korean side. For example, none of the disputed about high tide features in Spratly Island, the individually collectively, are capable of generating extent the maritime claims. We see that what happened in East Asia, see that this is Itaba, and this is Dokdo, and this is Okinawa Dorishima of the Japan. to see that Japan extend generate 200 nautical miles of this Okino Dorishima. It's about the 430,000 square kilometers to generate from this Okino Dorishima. So this outcome is give a very important implication for all state parties of in East Asia, Japan, Korea, and China, in terms of the state of features which they have. And the another issue is also like the China violate the sovereign rights of the Philippines in EEZ by interfering of the Philippines fishing and petroleum exploration activities, and constructing artificial island and failing to prevent the Chinese fishermen from fishing in the Philippines EEZ. The issues also, you know, touch upon the environmental protection obligation of the protect or preserve the environment, the law from the UNCLOS, and that is the cause the another issues to Korea and I think the partly to Japan. For example, the as I already mentioned that this is the Dokdo Ocean Observation Center. We tried to build a territorial sea of the Dokdo, which is still pending, and the government decided not to build the for a while. And this is the what happened the Okino Dorishima. It's a year 2014, there is an accident when they built some of the infrastructure over there that caused the casualties. I believe that it was stopped to build to move on forward. And we know that this is a general understanding for us is that when we deal with this arbitration judgment and the based on the couple of issues we have from this region, we understand that the disputes that a state involved are covered by the declaration like Japan, Korea and China, which is not readily sidestepped. They said that there is the potential for the state to be forced to arbitration with another UNCLOS party because there is a line is a very broadening in terms of the level of law enforcement, EEZ, and environmental protection and other issues, but not for central issues under the dispute between them. So in other term, I believe that the, we are very safe but, because of declaration in terms of sovereignty or maritime delimitation, but there is, that does not necessarily mean that we are very safe to any legal issues from our neighboring states. And that is the one of the very salient issues for Korea government now, how we deal with that and how we move forward with these salient issues. So since time's up, I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Thakwu. I think it shows that the tribunal's decision in the Philippines-China case has serious implications for island disputes in other parts of the world. I think if I could sum up both the island dispute between China and Korea, or Japan and Korea, called Dokdo or Takashima, is probably a rock which cannot sustain human habitation and therefore be only entitled to 12 nautical miles under the law of the sea, and also Senkaku Jyayu between China and Japan, and then even undisputed islands Okini Torishima, which is the epitome of a rock which is under Japanese sovereignty, but which both Korea and China have at the UN challenged as a, not in a tribunal's case, but in discussions at the CLCS, have said that the Japanese should not be able to claim more than a 12-mile territorial sea around it. So whether the states concerned would accept the decision of the tribunal in the Philippines-China case has very very important practical consequences north of us as well. Our third speaker is Ms. Elina Noor, Director of Foreign Policy and Security Studies, the Institute of Strategic and International Studies, or ISIS from Malaysia. She'll be speaking on managing the South China Sea spillovers, cybersecurity as new space for competition or source for cooperation.
Thank you. That was a lengthy title. Thank you for the opportunity to be here, just steps away from the South China Sea, really, and to share some of my thoughts on the intersection of two domains, one established, the maritime domain, and the other emerging, which is the cyber domain. I understand that this will be the first time cyber will be discussed in this context, so I'm delighted. I do hope that I'm not the only one who is delighted and interested in this subject, because there's nothing worse than a combination of speaker self-indulgence, jet lag, and post-lunch stupor. Anyway, my compliments really to the organizers for this very intriguing and strategic angle. Because this conference is about the South China Sea, let me first provide an overview of the interactions in cyberspace related to the South China Sea, which has been going on since the mid-2000s. Let me then table some thoughts on the challenge of attribution and responsibility in cyberspace before offering, finally, some recommendations going forward. First, the nature of activities in cyberspace. Parallel to what's been going on at sea, there's been this humming buzz of activity in cyberspace related to tensions in the South China Sea. And I break it down in my paper to two categories, essentially hacking or website defacement, DDoS attacks for nationalist purposes, and intelligence collection by actors who may or may not be state entities. And I'll explain a little more about why this is important in the second part of my remarks. Hacking, website defacement, DDoS attacks, usually juvenile, disruptive, very rarely destructive. There are some potentially disturbing implications, but the second category, intelligence collection or espionage, is probably more unsettling, although not surprising or unexpected at all. So let me give some examples of hacking or website defacement. I think the Vietnamese in the room will be very familiar with some of these incidents. There's been a series of hacking and retaliatory actions between primarily China and the Philippines, and China and Vietnam. Now, I say those as though they're state actors, but we're really not sure whether the state was behind or supporting those actions or not. Many of these hacking incidents mirror the actual tensions at sea. So, for example, in 2012, if you recall, because of the Scarborough Shoal incident, what happened in cyberspace was this series of hacking incidents between Chinese and Filipino actors. So this primarily took place at the academic level. The University of Philippines website, for example, was defaced with the words, "We come from China!" exclamation mark. "Huang Yuan Island is ours." And then there was a retaliation attack against the China University Media Union website by anonymous hashtag Occupy Philippines, which replaced the union's website homepage content with a digitized image of Guy Fawkes' mask and the words, "Chinese government is clearly retarded," full stop. "Scarborough Shoal is ours," exclamation mark. So this went back and forth. Between 2011 to 2014, there was a series of attacks that actually only just stopped recently in July 2016 between Chinese and Vietnamese actors. In 2011, this group called Honker Union deployed some DDoS attacks to about 200 websites in Vietnam. In 2014, when China constructed the oil rig in Vietnam's EEZ, some 750 Vietnamese websites were hacked in the space of a week by two major Chinese groups, 1973 CN and Sky Eye. I don't know how these groups come up with their names. At the end of July 2016, so very recently, the flight information and loudspeaker systems at Hanoi and Ho Chi Minh City International Airports were defaced, and offensive messages were flashing on these systems about Vietnam and the Philippines. Also, the personal data of about 400,000 VIP customers of Vietnam Airlines was stolen and leaked. The 1937 CN group was believed to be responsible, but they've neither confirmed nor denied their responsibility. Now, these attacks are annoying and they're disruptive, to be sure, but they haven't actually physically destroyed anything yet. What they do raise is the possibility of escalation to actual kinetic incapacitation of critical infrastructure. So if you can imagine these flight information systems being defaced, being escalated to actual physical destruction of, say, civilian air traffic controls, then this is something that will need to be considered as we move forward. There's been some talk of A2AD action or strategies being developed, and I'd like to table the suggestion that if the A2AD strategy concretizes by any state party, their military weapon systems may be involved and incapacitated at some time in the future through hacking activities. What these attacks also do is they call into question the legal level of state responsibility where hacking is done by nationalist activists who may or may not be supported by their state, especially if those attacks result, as I said, in physical consequences. Let me now turn to intelligence connection or espionage. In my paper, I profile three studies. Most of them were released last year. There was one that was released this year. Those three studies are open source studies, so let me just put it out there. The qualifier is that I don't read Chinese very well at all, so there may be Chinese language reports that are out there that say the contrary. But these reports in particular are ones by FireEye, Kaspersky, Threat Connect, and F-Secure. So four private cybersecurity companies put out these reports, and all these reports point to China as the main driver of espionage activities. All but one of those cybersecurity companies do not actually identify China specifically, but one does. I won't go into the details of these reports, but basically what they say, and they're very similar, is that many of these groups, and they're called APT groups, Advanced Persistent Threat Groups, have focused their attention on Southeast Asian claimant states, key individuals, and domestic agencies within those states that are involved in the dispute in the South China Sea. The most recent report, the one put out by F-Secure in July 2016, also showed that these actors targeted Philippines agencies that were involved in the International Arbitral Tribunal case, as well as the organization of APEC. And this conclusion was arrived at mainly by looking at these groups' modus operandi, as well as their targeting and level of infrastructure and penetration. The one report that did specifically identify China as being behind these intelligence collection activities was the report put out by a group called Threat Connect. And it was a report called Project Camera Shy, Closing the Aperture on China's Unit 78020. This report fingered China specifically, as I mentioned, and associated the group with the PLA's Chengdu Military Region, 2nd Technical Reconnaissance Bureau, Military Unit Cover Designator 78020. And then the report goes on to prove how it came to this very definitive conclusion that the APT group called Nikon equals China. You can easily Google the report. It's available. Like I said, it's open source. Let me just pick up on one case study, and this is really from a report that was released in 2014, again by Threat Connect. And this really goes to show that it's very dangerous. I know many of us, many government officials as well, like to use accounts like Hotmail and Yahoo to convey even confidential information. But this particular case really shows how dangerous that is. In 2013, there was a special ASEAN-China foreign ministers meeting. And what happened was talking points prepared by a government official was appropriated and was, so to speak, weaponized. So this was a Microsoft Word document that had been prepared. And it was taken by a Chinese group, presumably. And it was sent out to mine information to all its recipients. Now, the perpetrators behind this attack had registered their domains under the email address ivyfatima.ferrer@yahoo.com. Ivy Fatima Ferrer was an assistant in the Office of ASEAN Affairs of the Philippines Department of Foreign Affairs. And her email address was very, very similar to the email address that was appropriated and used. You can read more about this in F-Secure's paper called, on this group called Nan Hai Shu. Now let me move on very quickly to the problem of attribution. There are at least three levels of attribution that states have to grapple with if they're going to assign responsibility to a state actor. Technical attribution, which relies on operational skills to track and locate the attack source. Political attribution, which is really an assignment of responsibility to the attack's author, executioner, and sponsor. And legal attribution. What type of law should apply in the event of an attack? Espionage usually goes unpunished because international law is unclear on the matter. So all the APT incidents related to intelligence communication might simply raise caution and nothing else. But where there are attacks, like I said, if there are hacking attacks that actually result in kinetic consequences, then there are a whole host of questions that come to rise for state actors to be able to take any appropriate and commensurate responses. And I'm happy to talk more about this in the discussion session later on. Now, what are the cooperation possibilities moving forward? I've listed two in my paper, regional and international. A lot of Southeast Asian states prefer to focus on cyberspace as a means to advance trade, economics, and commerce. Not many countries are willing to talk about strategic issues at all. The recent proposal by the Philippines to propose an EWG on cybersecurity within the ADMM Plus structure is a good way of moving forward. Whether it will actually come to fruition in a meaningful and substantial way is a different question that I think the EWG will have to figure out for itself. I do suggest one way of looking at things, which is to adopt within the ASEAN region and with China, a set of norms that was proposed by the UN Group of Governmental Experts in 2015. And the most important part of this list of norms is really that international law applies when there is an attack in cyberspace. My time is up. I'm happy to talk more about this if there are any questions later on. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we'll move directly to our final speaker, Dr. Thuy from the Diplomatic Academy of Vietnam, who will be dealing with regional security and cooperation structures in dealing with South China Sea issues, conflicts, overlaps, and possible new mechanisms. Dr. Thuy.
Thank you, Professor. In my presentation, we can identify the current mechanisms or frameworks or cooperation for cooperation and management or discussion of the South China Sea and maritime related issue in the region. And we try to identify what is overlapping areas, where's the gap, and make some proposal. So first we will discuss, we will explore what is current existing cooperation mechanism. It's not working. Okay. I will talk about cooperation on maritime security, on environmental protection, on scientific research, and on resources exploration, exploitation, and also the framework discussion on the maritime issue. First, on the issue of maritime securities, we have several bilateral, trilateral mechanisms relating to maritime security and also multilateral mechanism. Regarding bilateral, we have, for example, we have between Vietnam and China, we have joint patrol and coordinated patrol mechanism in the Gulf of Tonkin, We have joint patrol between Vietnam and Cambodia in the Gulf of Thailand. We have joint patrol between Vietnam and Thailand, also in the Gulf of Thailand. In Malacca Stress Patrol, we have Masindo system with involvement of Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore. And we heard recently announcement of Indonesia and Malaysia and Philippines trilateral patrol in the area between three countries. So you can see the area of this kind of cooperation mainly happen outside of South China Sea. Somewhere nearby the South China Sea, but not within the South China Sea. We have a multilateral mechanism is RICAP based in Singapore. And this mechanism is mainly for exchange of information on armed robbery and piracy at sea. They don't have mechanism for coordinating activity directly on the sea. Regarding marine scientific research, we have bilateral and also multilateral, trilateral mechanism between Vietnam, Philippines, and China, and just South China Sea. That particular coordination is happen within the South China Sea. That is joint oceanographic and marine scientific research expedition since 1996. The first two, including China, they agree, but have not yet operationalized this kind of activities. And we have some joint marine scientific research between China and Vietnam in the Gulf of Tonkin, and some projects within the framework of workshop on managing the potential conflict in the South China Sea. Broader framework, we have COPSEA, coordinating body on the seas of East Asia. That is main task is for assessment of the effects of human activity on the maritime environment and coordinating activity between government and NGO and other agencies. And we have 10 members, including own claimants, almost own, and some outsiders. And other countries such as Korea and Singapore. We have partnership in environmental management for seas of East Asia. Also 11 countries and 14 non-state partners. And we have within the UN framework, we have Global Environmental Facility, South China Sea Projects, partners with 7 countries, including Cambodia, China, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Thailand, and Vietnam. And that is also to create the environmental and regional level to collaborate in and partnership in addressing environmental issue and to enhance capacity. So if you can look at the other aspect of cooperation, we have cooperation on living resources and non-living resources. Regarding living resources, we have Vietnam-Cambodia agreement in the Gulf of Tonkin, Vietnam-China fisherman agreement in the Gulf of Tonkin also, for managing and for develop and manage the fishery potential. We have ASEAN, Southeast Asia Fisherman Development Center, and that is the mainly for sharing knowledge and coordination. But they also they do not address the issue of overlapping claim or fishing activity in the South China Sea. On the issue of resources, we have some bilateral agreement. We have Vietnam, Malaysia, the successful agreement in the Gulf of Thailand. And we have Malaysia, Thailand, Thailand, Cambodia, MOU. In the Gulf of Tonkin, we have Vietnam and China. But this is the existing, but I don't think any drop of oil is going to be exploited in the soon period. And we have ongoing negotiation in the mouth of the Tonkin. In the South China Sea, we have Malaysia and Brunei arrangement. Multilaterally, for non-living resources, is more difficult. And we have ongoing negotiation between Vietnam, Thailand, and Malaysia in the Gulf of Tonkin. In the South China Sea, we have GMSU, China, Philippines, and Vietnam, but it's expired in 2005. That is the current mechanism for cooperation directly on the sea. Regarding mechanism for discussion on the cooperation, we can suppress discussion on the table like this conference or meeting and the cooperation on the sea. Regarding the mechanism for discussion, we have a lot of mechanism for dealing with the issue. And if you can see here on the table, I think it's quite difficult. And we have a lot of mechanism. And here's a chart that the Vice Minister also used in dinner 2 days ago. We can see the integrated noodle and spaghetti and pho's here, yeah, with a lot of mechanism, including bilateral and multilateral, and relating to several, relating to different aspects of cooperation. But I will provide more simple chart to better understanding. So the general observation from my own is that we can see cooperation directly on the sea regarding maritime security does not cover the South China Sea. Just one gap. Marine scientific research and environmental protection are considered less sensitive, therefore easier for party to achieve cooperation. As you see, we have a lot of mechanism for environmental protection and scientific research. Cooperation for development of resources, both living and non-living, fish, oil, gas, are mainly concentrating in the Gulf of Thailand and Gulf of Tonkin, bilaterally or trilaterally, and very difficult to reach any kind of arrangement in the South China Sea. We have only GMSU that is in exploration, in initial exploration, and expired already. And we don't have any mechanism to avoid incidents and manage incidents, especially to manage incidents. Between China and Vietnam, we have Q, but as we discussed, that did not apply to coast guards. And I don't think in the near future it can apply to fishing boats or paramilitaries. We have a lot of incidents happen involving fishing boats and paramilitary. DOC discussed a loss, but no practical cooperation yet. So the reason is that, the reason for that is that we have territory dispute, so it's more sensitive, and we don't have a clear picture of maritime overlapping of maritime claims. So it's quite difficult to identify possible area for cooperation. And also we see situation of unilateral activity that did undermine the trust between parties. So without trust, it's very difficult to promote practical cooperation. And more important is that we have multilateral in nature of dispute of overlapping area, but we don't have appropriate mechanism for negotiation. So you can see here, that is current mechanism for discussion of maritime and South China Sea issue. We have South China Sea workshops, including China, ASEAN, and Taiwan also. And we have some framework, a lot of frameworks within ASEAN, as we today discussed, ASEAN, ADMM, ASEAN Maritime Forums, Navy Chief and Coast Guard Chief within ASEAN. They discuss on issue relating to maritime, including South China Sea. And we have DOC and COC discussion between ASEAN and China. And I think COC is similar to TPP. It's very difficult to reach. And we have EAS, ADMM Plus, and Extended ASEAN Maritime Forum involving 10 members and partners within EAF, including China, US, Japan, Korea, India, Australia, New Zealand, and Russia. And we have broader framework of AIF, including other parties of AIF. So if you see that map, that chart is more simple, but what is lacking here? Lacking here is mechanism for directly concerned party in South China Sea. We don't have, we have five parties countries, five countries party, but no mechanism. We don't have mechanism for coastal states meeting. Surrounding South China Sea don't have official mechanism for discussion of the issue. But that is very important because according to international law, and especially after the tribunal ruling, now we can have more clear picture of the South China Sea. When the South China Sea become a semi-enclosed sea, and according to UN's Article 123, the semi-enclosed sea can open a lot of opportunity for surrounding parties to coordinate on living resources, on scientific research, on environment, and on other issues. And also we have, we have the issue here of fishing activity within 12 nautical miles of land feature in the South China Sea. So according to the ruling, the fishermen can enjoy maybe historical rights of fishing here. So we need some kind of cooperation in managed fishing activities in the South China Sea. And we have, as we discussed, we have the high sea and maybe international seabed in the center of the South China Sea. And that is involving interests of other parties as well. And we don't have mechanism to discuss about that. So my proposal is also to create some kind of mechanism for coastal state meeting or claimants meeting. Of course, that is we have the issue of Taiwan status, but Taiwan is also an independent fishing entity, so may create some precedent. So the mechanism is for discussing relevant issue in appropriate mechanism. So we can have discuss marine scientific research and other activity, oil and gas development, environment, law enforcement, rule of law, overfly and peaceful settlement in appropriate mechanism. And I leave the chance for you to study more. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure I agree with some of your suggestions on low-hanging fruits. I've been involved in this issue for about a quarter of a century. I think going back to the South China Sea workshops organized by Indonesia, and one of the difficulties there was marine scientific research. We could not get any agreement because of the areas of overlapping claims again. And under the law of the sea, the coastal state can approve marine scientific research in its economic zone. And therefore, we could never get agreement because everyone said it's their economic zone. So the baseline study was done in the Natuna Islands, which is the one area in the South China Sea was not in dispute. But to get even a research vessel carrying a Swedish flag would be impossible because everyone would say you're entering our economic zone. So I don't see marine scientific research as an area of cooperation. The cooperation I've seen in that area is exchanging data on things within your territorial sovereignty, not any cooperation except for bilateral, I believe, between the Philippines and Vietnam at one point in history. So I'd like you to comment on that, but also on fisheries. Again, people have been calling on fisheries in this forum and fisheries cooperation, but in 20 years I've never seen a meeting in which China would discuss fisheries cooperation in the South China Sea. Most of the time, the people that agree there should be fisheries cooperation, there's never anyone from the fisheries agency present in the room. Many countries in this region do not have control over their fishing industries, so it would be hard for them to agree to cooperate. So I think fisheries is, again, an extremely difficult issue unless states would be willing to control the vessels flying their flag and the vessels owned by their nationals. But they're not going to agree to any regime which lets other states' enforcement agencies arrest vessels flying their flag or dealing with their nationals. But maybe you can reply to my intentionally provocative discussion.
I think we agree that the less sensitive issue is more easy to achieve some kind of cooperation. And so, of course, scientific research and marine environmental protection are less sensitive in cooperation with the resources exploitation. On marine scientific research, yes, it's quite sometimes difficult to agree for joint activity within the area of claim by one party and other protested. But I think since the tribunal ruling, it can open more room for this kind of activity because we can apply the regime of semi-enclosure here, and also we have a big area of high sea in the middle of South China Sea, or maybe international seabed in the South China Sea. That would, if according to the ruling, it will not be the area of overlapping claims. On fishing activities, also similar, because how can, if we can manage the fishermen from own surrounding countries in doing fishing activity in the center of South China Sea, everyone can go, yeah, according to international law. So how can we manage that that competition between fishermen? And also within the area of territory sea of the land features, if we see the implication of Scarborough, when the tribunal decided that fishermen from own countries can enjoy historical fishing rights, so that can help implication for other territory sea of other land features. So if fishermen from one country enter the territory sea of other the feature controlled by other party, what will happen if we have some kind of class or incident there?
Let's open it for questions. Let's take maybe four questions and then let the speakers respond. Do we have Bill Hayton?
Thank you, Bill Hayton, Chatham House, UK. My question is really for Professor Turk, possibly following on from my comments yesterday. I wonder if you want to say something about the interaction between provisions in UNCLOS, particularly in the light of the tribunal ruling in July, positions taken by the CLCS and state practice, and how they all work together to form a new, potentially new doctrine.
Thank you, Yinghui Song from Academia Seneca. Mr. Hayton, the question you raised is my first question. Now, Judge Turk, I would like to ask you, different training and expertise are found in the ITALUS, COCS, and the International Seabed Authority. Is there any need, any possibility for the heads of the three institutions to sit together and to discuss relevant, important law of the sea question? For example, a feature which is identifies as a rock within the meaning of Article 121, Paragraph 3, to generate 200 nautical miles exclusive economic zone and continental shelf, and beyond the 200 nautical miles continental shelf. So that's first question. Second question I would like to ask you, Judge Turk, what is or what are the main reasons for the UN Secretary General Office and the ICJ to distance themselves from the July 2016 ruling? What are the main reasons? And the last one, as you are the, you were the former vice president of the ITALUS, were there any actions, any intention done by the judges of the ITALAS to urge, to ask the government of the United States to ratify or to accede to the 1982 Law of the Sea Conventions? So, Mr. Chairman, if I'm allowed, I have two questions to Dr. Tui. Do I wait next time, or should I raise my question now? Later. Okay, I'll hold it right here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Z from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And I have one question to your talk about the competence of the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea. In your presentation, you said the tribunal is open for other entities, for entities other than the state parties of the convention. However, could you please clarify whether these entities are the ones provided in article, only the ones provided in article 305 of the convention, or the other entities like enterprises or individuals such as fishermen? Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm Stuart Shaw. I'm from the Canadian Mission to ASEAN in Jakarta. And my question is for Ms. Alina, and it's considering that there's a kind of global debate about how the internet will work between people who would like to see a very free internet and a very state-controlled internet, and then just the nature of how cyber attacks work, where do you see the first step coming for cooperation? I mean, is it something that states can do? And would states be willing to let non-state actors start some sort of confidence building without them? Thank you.
Just address the questions in relation to the CLCS. If we go back to the history, why was the CLCS created? Because on the one hand, the coastal states insisted that it's their prerogative to delineate the outer edge of the continental shelf. And the notion of the continental shelf had been expanded beyond the geological shelf to the outer edge of the continental margin. And at the same time, where there is no geological shelf to the 200-mile limit, so we have a legal continental shelf enshrined in the convention. And the commission was supposed to be created to serve as a kind of watchdog against excessive coastal state claims. But what was, however, completely underestimated, the complex issues involved and the number of countries claiming entitlements beyond 200 nautical miles and the difficulties on the ground to submit the data, to gather the necessary data. And it was also overlooked, or perhaps it was done on purpose, in order to limit the competence, the expertise of the commission, that no lawyers have been included. And this was really a mistake, because in the work of the commission, legal issues arise all the time. And how do these members resolve these issues? Well, they ask questions to the United Nations Secretariat, to the legal office, because they have no possibility to ask for advice, let's say, from the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, which would have been very sensible had there been such a possibility. But unfortunately, this does not exist. And as regards the savings clause to which I referred, well, the Commission is really very careful to defer all submissions where there is a dispute. How can states overcome this situation? Well, Bangladesh and Myanmar is a case in point. They decided to submit their dispute, which had lasted for 36 years, to binding dispute resolution by the tribunal. So you had a judgment, and now the underlying philosophy was this: if states can agree on a delimitation and therefore unlock the situation in which the Commission is unable to act, they can also submit the dispute to binding resolution, and the judgment sort of takes the place of the bilateral agreement between the countries concerned, and the impasse is resolved. So in the case Bangladesh-Myanmar, a very important precedent was set by the tribunal. Now, as regards the possibilities of the heads of the institutions to get together, well, there are quite intense contacts between the tribunal and the International Seabed Authority and the Secretary General of the Seabed Authority and the legal advisor have come to Hamburg at the seat of the tribunal for an exchange of views with the judges. But that is easier because there is a link between the ISA and the tribunal, which does not exist in the case of the Commission and the other bodies, because the Commission is a treaty body and not an autonomous international organization. And the Commission faces a further problem because the members are serving in their individual capacities, are being paid by their respective countries, and the developing countries have a very difficult time to send experts for 21 weeks or more to New York at government expense. And this creates a problem for the quorum of the Commission. And there is a trust fund, but the trust fund is more or less depleted. And if no additional money can be raised until the beginning of next year, the Commission might not have a quorum for its work at its spring session in New York. And this would further delay the consideration of submissions. And as I said before, the original idea was that there would be about up to 35 countries claiming a shelf beyond 200 nautical miles. Now it's well over 80, so we do not know the exact number. And the comment I make that the provisions of the convention concerning the shelf beyond 200 nautical miles might perhaps be different, because I doubted whether the conference would have agreed to these existing provisions had the delegates known that there would be such a large number making claims to entitlements going out that far into the ocean, and thus really greatly diminishing the international seabed area. And the question of rocks and islands, of course, can be informally discussed by the heads of the institutions, but this does not resolve the issues. The reasons for the Secretary General of the ICJ to distance themselves from the July ruling, as Professor Song alluded to, well, I cannot give you the reasons because I have not been privy to any considerations by the Secretary General or the ICJ in this respect. But this is a ruling by an ad hoc arbiter tribunal, and we do not know whether a future arbiter tribunal will adopt the same position or not, or whether the ICJ or the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea will concur with that opinion. This really remains to be seen. That's why it is my view that if there is a fundamental question of interpretation of a universal convention, it's much safer to submit this question to a permanent judicial institution and not to an ad hoc tribunal, because I believe in the case of a permanent institution, you have a more authoritative legal position which may be more easily be accepted by the members of the international community. Of course, not necessarily. There may always be dissenters and persistent objectors. And the danger of conflicting interpretation of such provisions might certainly be reduced. On the other hand, you have the problem that arbitration is a default procedure, and you would need agreement between countries in dispute to submit such a question to a permanent institution, whereby, as regards arbitration, you can do this unilaterally. As regards the United States, well, I have myself informally tried to speak to American politicians, and some were very favorable. And let's not forget, the Senate Foreign Relations Committee has twice recommended adherence of the United States to the convention. but the matter has never been put on the agenda of the plenary Senate because of resistance by a certain group of senators. And I will not forget, when I was in Washington, I spoke to a very distinguished lady, and she said, yes, law of the sea. Well, my father was an admiral, and my son was an admiral. Don't talk to me about this horrible convention. But this is not the general view. Now, as regards access to the tribunal, I already mentioned that access can be considered as the most important difference between the ICJ and ITLOS. Well, in the case of the Law of the Sea Convention, also international organizations can become parties to the convention. Therefore, it's not only states, but also international organizations have an access to the dispute resolution system, but also natural or legal persons in any case expressly provided for in Part 11 of the convention, because when your exploitation of the deep seabed will hopefully start, then there may be disputes between companies or also disputes between a company engaged in exploitation and the International Seabed Authority. And such a dispute would then be submitted to the Seabed Dispute Chamber of the tribunal, which is a tribunal within a tribunal consisting of 11 judges. And what is remarkable in this connection is that the decisions of the Seabed Dispute Chamber are enforceable in the territories of the states parties in the same manner as judgments or orders of the highest court of the state party in whose territory the enforcement is sought. And this is a very unique provision which gives great power to an international judicial institution which cannot be found anywhere else. And that's why the US State Department, when it prepared for a possible adherence by the US, inserted a clause to be suggested to the Senate that the decisions of the Seabed Dispute Chamber could not override decisions by the United States Supreme Court. And other countries may have the same problem. So I think I've tried to answer more or less the questions posed. Thank you.
Professor Song, actually, let me offer you an insight. One of the ICJ judges said that he, and this may not be reflective of the whole composition of the ICJ, but one of the judges said that it was his personal principle to reserve comment on the decision of another tribunal. The question about non-state actors and CBMs, basically, in short, the onus has to be on the states to establish those CBMs. There are two sets of splits. One is between non-state actors, primarily industry and technologists, and states. The other is a split in ideology, in doctrine among states, as you rightly alluded to. And even among the states, it will be difficult to converge those opinions and views on how to set those CBMs on the right path. But again, I would refer you to the UNGGE 2015. Canada was a member. And their proposal of the set of 11 norms. And I think this consensus document that was offered to the world was really quite seminal because it brought together some very, very diametrically opposed views. And, you know, there may be criticism that it was only 25 countries that were represented and therefore not representative of the whole world, but I think it does set a very good example of a beginning for those CBMs.
Just one comment for the non-lawyers in the room. In terms of the UNCLOS dispute settlement system, we must bear in mind that almost all states in the region are parties to the convention, the exception of Cambodia and the United States, if you say the United States is in the region. And there, if any dispute arises on interpretation or application, either one party can take the other without their consent because you're agreeing to the system when you ratify the convention. The other issue, of course, is that Taiwan is not recognized as a state by the United Nations, so they're not a party, even though they are an entity bordering the South China Sea and a major fishing entity whose cooperation would be required for any sustainable management of fisheries. Next questions.
A question to Elena's excellent presentation on the cyber dimension. I'm working myself in this area too, and I have followed what was actually happening the years before also in Europe as well as in the United States in this respect. And so just firstly a very short comment and then a question. The comment has to do with what you mentioned, you hinted, but you didn't say it explicitly, but APTs, advanced persistent threats, are understood worldwide by energy experts, can only be conducted with state support. They are so sophisticated, it is not possible that any kind of private hacker group can do that for the time being. So that means we're speaking here also for a number of other reasons and proofs that there is a state-supported attack worldwide taking place, be it from secret services, be it from the PA or other forces, but there is a state support included. And that is very alarming in many ways. The question has to do with the recent news cybersecurity reports which came out, which were comparing the institutionalized expertise and the level of quality of cybersecurity in the various regions of the world. And the alarming conclusion was that Asia, in comparison with America and Europe, lacks or the quality is even much worse. And the conclusion was this is very dangerous indeed also for the European Asian trade and the overall economic importance of the Asia Pacific region to the world economy. Because you can easily interrupt in the maritime area, whether it's harbors or other fields. So if there is not enough institutional expertise on a national base, I think it also limits the room of maneuver if you work together. This is not an argument to do it together, because an exchange of information would at least raise awareness of these kind of new security challenges we face. But the first step, yeah, in addressing these things is to do your homework. And here, that relates both to governments as well as to the private industry and economy. So I would be interested in when you proposed to work together strongly also here within the ASEAN framework, how you see the prospects of enhancing that kind of cooperation when you obviously have a problem on a national base even of having an institutional expertise here.
I take a couple more questions, but I'd ask if you try to keep your questions short and sweet, if you can, so we have more opportunity. A couple more.
I have a short and sweet question to Professor Lee. It's about a dream I've had in four versions. The second morning I wake up and the president of China and the president of the Philippines have a press conference and they say, we have agreed that Scarborough Shoal is disputed among ourselves. It's a rock. It can have 12 nautical mile territorial sea and we will have a fishery agreement. On the third night, I dream that ASEAN and China, and also with Taiwan represented in some way, we have a press conference and they say that we have the same agreement for the Spratly Islands. And then on the next night, it's Japan's prime minister and the Chinese president, and they say the same thing about Senkaku. But the first night is about Dokdo. On the first night, the Korean president and the Japanese prime minister have this press conference. And I thought that this was such a simple dream because Korea controls it. It's so easy to do it. There is a fishery agreement. Everything works. So it could be resolved overnight. But then when I presented it in Korea, it turns out that each time I talk about this to Koreans, the Koreans start talking about comfort women instead. So my question to you is the Dokdo conflict about Dokdo or is it about comfort women?
Professor Song, you had one more question.
Thank you. My questions are addressed to Dr. Dui. Actually, Professor Beckman disagreed with your comments of your suggestion, your presentation. I'd agree with your suggestion. And because after the July 2016 award, and it's very important, I should say this, let's keep hope alive. In particular, with regard to the implementation of Part 9 of the UNCLOS, and it's very important to take note the president of the WCPFC, the Western Pacific Fisheries Management Organizations. So there's a possibility for the country in the region to follow the award and think about to apply Part 9 of the convention regarding IUU fishing. So the possibilities are there to prevent, to take action to prevent deter and combat IUU fishing. So that's the one comment. My question to Dr. Tui is, in May 2015, there was a peaceful proposal by Taiwan, South China Sea Peace Initiative. And then in January this year, a roadmap was announced. I would like to ask you the question is, what's the reaction from Vietnam? What's the reaction from ASEAN as a group? Thank you.
Thank you for the questions. As you know, the Korean president is quite busy in these days for political scandal in Korea, so I don't think she even has the time to dream. But the question you address is quite correct. As you might know, that the historical issues, including comfort women, was settled by a bilateral way this end of the last year. And what the Korean government tried to do is that a little bit detached from the territorial or maritime issues from the historical setting. I think the leaders of the both countries were aware of that. But the problem is that the domestic politics of peoples do not understand. They try to connect those issues. So let me put it this way, is that all issues in East Asia, I believe, is a bilateral nature. But in some sense, they have a multilateral character. So what we have to do is that take the pure issues one by one, so more addressed easily to solve up. And I'm hoping that, as you addressed, that if we go in that way, I think the territory issues and maritime delimitation issues can be solved, and then the area can be proposed that the common area for both countries to use as a joint development or joint fishing area. But that is just an idea, because I think in public sense, the reason I can talk is that I'm the only one Korean here, so I feel comfortable to say that. But if I say this one in Korea, in publicly, I don't think I can survive in Korea. So it's a sensitivity of the Korean domestic politics is quite deviate of what we talk and what you understand actually here.
There's a reluctance to definitively attribute responsibility for a number of reasons, right? And depending on who you speak to, attribution is either getting easier or it's not going anywhere with the help of technological advancement. And I think states prefer to play it safe, so to speak, because of, particularly in the Southeast Asian region, this lack of technological capabilities, this desire not to want to escalate political tensions, and quite simply, the uncertainty of what's available to them, what kind of recourse is available to them, legally speaking. I mean, that debate is still very much unsettled. At the technical level, I think CERTs work very well together, computer emergency response teams in the region. And they work so well seamlessly that the technical problems actually are resolved very quickly. The problem, as you alluded to, is this lack of even basic awareness of the problems surrounding the strategic aspect of cyberspace. And I think part of it stems from this unwillingness to acknowledge that there is a problem, a growing problem, that will only get worse without proper policy direction that will help guide the technical response teams to work even better in an event of a conflict.
On comment of Professor Song, I, I agree that we should apply the Part 9 of UNCLOS for the South China Sea, but I think it's apply not only for IUU fishing, but more importantly, it's apply for official fishing, for legal fishing in the area of no one maritime areas. That means the area in the high sea of the South China Sea. Who will enforce jurisdiction in that area is a big issue. And also, as I mentioned, the area around the land feature, in the turnoutic miles of land feature in the South China Sea. On reaction to Taiwan peace initiative, I think it's because of the official status of Taiwan. We don't have, between Vietnam and ASEAN also, we don't have any kind of official relationship. So I don't see any official reaction until now. But I think generally speaking from ASEAN and other claimants, I think they welcome all of initiatives that are contributing to peace and security and development in the region. And my comment is that since the initiative was proposed by previous administration, so maybe Taiwan have to make another proposal or modify or something or to propose again, because you have a change in administration, and whether the new administration will follow your previous policy is a big question here also.
Just like to make one final comment regarding the enforcement of decisions. It is obvious the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea has no possibility to enforce any of its decisions, nor does any arbitral tribunal. In theory, there's a certain difference as regards the International Court of Justice, because the United Nations Security Council could enforce a judgment by the ICJ. But this has never happened, so the distinction, this difference, is purely theoretical. In practice, it's the same. The tribunal has had one case of non-participation by a state party. This was the case of Russia as regards the detention of the vessel and the persons on board of the Arctic Sunrise. And Russia has not participated and has not accepted the decision by the tribunal. But in that case, Russia adopted an amnesty law to release the persons which had been detained, and a few months later also released the vessel. So, although not accepting the judgment by ITLOS on the basis of its domestic legislation, it de facto complied with the decision. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Is there a final question? If not, I will make one plea from the chair. I think the two areas that can be low-key, I'll get to you. I just want to make two points. Low-hanging fruits to me are marine environment, especially for matters that are within the control of the states bordering the South China Sea. They should be following the tribunal, which says that you have a duty to ensure that any activities under your jurisdiction and control comply with the best environmental practices. And I would urge all states that are occupying islands to ensure that they comply with the best international environmental practices and make their practices publicly available. The other area that is in great need of addressing is the area of fisheries, because the fisheries people are usually never in the room. The states around the South China Sea have not ratified the relevant fisheries agreements of the FAO. They have not ratified the 95 fish stocks agreement. They have not talked seriously about creating a regional management fisheries organization to sustainably deal with fisheries. And unless action is taken, we're all going to be eating farmed fish within the next 5 or 10 years, because there are going to be no fish left in the South China Sea. So to me, that would be a matter of urgency, and I don't sense that anyone wants to talk about cooperation on fisheries, and I find that very disconcerting. Final question over here. Sorry for preaching, but I can't help it. Yes. There was a final question on the side here.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, to save time, so first of all, I must say thank you very much for all the speakers for their interesting and fascinating presentations. Well, I have two questions Charles Turk. Also concerning the CLCS. Well, I have learned that in the formulation of the rules, the procedures of CLCS, there was lacking of the legal assistance in the formulation of those rules, the procedure. Therefore, in light of that procedure, any application unreasonably encountering objection or opposition from any coastal state might be left untouched forever. So, in this regard, according to you, how or to what extent you can suggest to rectify this problem? And also to my second question, also concerning actually it could be a comment rather than a question, also concerning what Chostok said in the presentation earlier. He said that concerning the issues, I mean the fundamental issues of universal nature should be rendered, I mean by the permanent institution, in this case namely it laws. So that just because of its authority in nature, but I wonder what. Well, this is something to do with the will of the sovereign states. I mean, back to the very bottom line, well, all sovereign states are equal, so they have chosen the procedure. So whatsoever, whether it is permanent or not, so I think it should be treated equally. So just my comment, and just in this regard, if you can clarify further, so I would be more than happy to hear. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, first question relating to the Commission on the limits of the continental shelf. I already explained it was a mistake not to include lawyers in such a commission because they're faced with legal questions all the time. But as regards the rules of procedure, the power of the Commission to adopt its own rules of procedure was not even foreseen. So there was a consultation between the Commission members and the United Nations Secretariat, and then it was said, in order to fulfill its obligations under the Convention, we have to rely on implied powers to adopt the rules of procedure. And this is what happened. As regards permanent institutions and ad hoc tribunals, also pointed out that there was a suggestion at the conference to make ITLAS the default procedure if there is no agreement on the choice of mechanism, but this was not accepted because a number of countries at that time and perhaps today believe there is less intrusion into their sovereignty if they have the possibility to establish an ad hoc arbitral tribunal in a given case and have an influence on the composition of this arbitral tribunal. That is certainly a very valid argument, but if there is no agreement on the composition of the arbitral tribunal, then the situation is quite different because in such a case, the president of ITLAS has the power to appoint the remaining arbitrators. So this power no longer rests with the states, but has devolved to the president of ITLOS. As regards the legal standing by decision of the ICJ, ITLOS, or ad hoc arbitral tribunal, it is the same. It's legally binding only on the parties. But the radiation, I would say, of a decision is probably greater from a political point of view if it's a permanent institution where all geographical regions and all legal systems are represented. But that's a political assessment. It's not a legal one.
And with that, I'd like to draw the session to a close. There's a coffee break coming, but before you leave, please join me in thanking the panel.